The nutrients I've covered so far in this series all have the potential to be too low on a plant-based diet, but recently I had a query about manganese, with which we have the opposite problem. It can be too high. In fact, deficiency of this essential trace element is uncommon and is not a problem with almost any kind of diet. But like we saw with phytate in my video on zinc, manganese can be thought of as a marker of healthy diets given that it is mostly found in plants and so can approach the tolerable upper intake level in diets rich in plant matter, and it is actually quite easy to exceed this upper limit. The question is, how much of a problem is this? Well, first of all, why must there be an upper limit set at all? Other nutrients like chromium, vitamin K, and certain B vitamins have no defined tolerable upper intake level, so what's so bad about manganese? We know that high levels are in fact dangerous, primarily from cases of occupational inhalation of manganese dust, and also drinking manganese contaminated water, which can result in the permanent neurological disorder known as manganism, characterized by Parkinson's-like symptoms. So it has been established that we do indeed need to define an intake level above which we should not go to prevent these adverse health consequences. Unfortunately, an actual threshold level that would result in pathology has not been established, so the best we have to go on is observation of populations that do not have any health consequences of excess, and what their level of intake is. Following a conservative approach, the National Academy of Medicine has set this upper limit at 11 mg per day for all adults based on data presented by Dr. Greger. No, not the one you're thinking of. J.L. Greger presented data indicating that people eating Western-type and vegetarian diets may have intakes as high as 10.9 mg per day. Manganese toxicity has not been observed in people eating Western-type or vegetarian diets, hence the choice of this number as the cutoff. However, it has been pointed out that determining manganese intake from different diets was not the focus of this study, but it merely included a reference to a review that itself referenced a single study from 1982 on 100 Canadian women, who were asked to report on their own normal diet on 3 consecutive weekdays. From this data, manganese intake was calculated and found to be as high as 10.8 mg. So the upper limit set by the National Academy of Medicine is actually based off calculated data and not actual measurement of intake, in this one observational study that did not examine health status. So it would appear that the tolerable upper intake level set by the Institute of Medicine as they were known back then is not founded on very strong science, and it is not surprising that other authorities have not set upper limits. Additionally, manganese from food seems to be less absorbable and toxic than from contaminated water, possibly by an order of magnitude or more, and manganese toxicity from food has not been reported. Remember, the basis for establishing an upper limit is from cases of inhalation and water contamination. We also appear to be able to adapt to a wide range of intakes by boosting or decreasing absorption. And even though manganese intake may be higher in healthier diets, these same healthy diets may also provide protection against absorbing too much of this manganese. Calcium, phosphorus, and phytate have all been reported to impair absorption of manganese and are all found in healthy whole plant foods. All of this could be used to argue that perhaps the 11 mg tolerable upper intake level is a bit too strict, but despite this, I still recommend staying under this limit as much as possible. Manganese in water is thought to be more toxic than from food, but it is also possible that waterborne manganese becomes even more toxic to those already consuming a lot of manganese from food on a plant-based diet. Another potential concern is that manganese may share absorption mechanisms with iron, and it is possible that those who have developed iron deficiency anemia as a result of a poorly planned plant-based diet may increase their manganese absorption as an unintended consequence of the upregulation of iron absorption. High manganese intake would also be problematic in the case of undiagnosed liver disease, as the liver's ability to eliminate the element becomes impaired. Given all of these points, along with the knowledge that the consequences of manganese toxicity are so severe, and the fact that there is no good test for manganese status to titrate level of intake, I recommend staying under the National Academy of Medicine's tolerable upper intake level as much as possible. I also recommend that you track your usual diet with chronometer for a few days and have a look at your manganese intake. Make sure you aren't regularly exceeding the upper limit with your staple foods, and if you are, try to substitute some of them for foods lower in manganese. In summary, those eating plant-based diets have a higher chance of exceeding the tolerable upper intake level for manganese. This level does not have a strong scientific basis, but given that the consequences of excess are severe, among several other factors, it is still best to take in less than this amount. It would be wise to determine your own intake and modify your diet if it is too high. Let me know in the comments if you've already tracked your manganese intake and what kind of level of intake you're getting. Thanks for watching, and I hope this video has given you a better understanding of the essential trace element, manganese. Be sure to share this video with anyone you know that might be worried about high manganese. If there was something that wasn't clear from the video, feel free to let me know in the comments and I'll get back to you. Give us a thumbs up if you found the video informative, and subscribe if you haven't already so you don't miss the next one. That's it for now though, guys. Talk to you soon. Sláinte.